basically, whenever you fail, it's your own fault.
This week on Backward Compatible, Jim and Nick talk about the relationship between challenge and fun in games. Plus, Hyperlight Drifter, Masks, Assassin's Creed Origins, Chroma Squad, and more. The Backward-Compatible.com podcast starts right now.
Hello, Backward Compatible listeners. This is episode 112 of the podcast, and I'm here with Nick.
Hello.
And Doc and Chris are actually unavailable today, so we have a two-man show for you.
Yeah, it's just the two of us.
Yeah. Don't turn it off just yet, though. We're going to have a good show for you. We're actually going to talk about the relationship between challenge and fun, and difficulty in games. Maybe mix in some flow theory, try to get a little psychological, talk Ooh. About some modern games that maybe test this a little bit more than others. We'll see. Good show.
Yep.
But let's start off with the button mosh.
Get ready for the button mosh, where the crew jumps in on the video games they've been rocking lately.
I just got Hyperlight Drifter.
Oh, I've heard of that. That's pretty good. Is it?
Yeah.
Is it 8-bit? Style or like a style?
Not really 8-bit, not really retro, but it's got the pixel art sort of aesthetic.
Okay.
It's got like really cool neon sort of color scheme, very futuristic. The gameplay, I would say it's kind of a cross between like a top-down 2D Zelda game. And well, this is how the developer actually described it, as a cross between Zelda and Diablo.
Diablo, really?
Yeah.
So what's the connection between those two?
I don't know what the connection between Diablo is. I guess it has something to do with the combat system. That's just what the developer said.
Okay.
But I see it more as just like Zelda with an interesting twist on it.
Are the dungeons generated somewhat procedurally?
No. Okay. Everything's really finely crafted.
Okay. Because Diablo was, I was wondering if that might be the connection, but I guess not.
No. I think it has more to do with the combat system, but I haven't played much Diablo, so I wouldn't know. It's set in this weird sort of futuristic fantasy world with, like, super high technology, but also it's got this fantasy aesthetic. So you've got, you know, wizards who shoot lasers and, you know, giant ogres. Or not ogres, but, like, giant monsters that have, you know, metal armor that, like, looks futuristic. And everything's got, like, a neon light sort of aesthetic.
And are you just, like, a warrior with a sword?
Basically, yeah. Okay. So you're what's called the Drifter. And there's this cutscene at the beginning of the game.
The Drifter.
Yeah, Hyperlight Drifter. There's this cutscene at the beginning of the game that basically explains how... what's going on, but it doesn't really explain much, because what's cool is that there's no words anywhere in the game except for the occasional tooltip. So you're basically just seeing a lot of visual storytelling. So there's this really kind of trippy intro cinematic that's a little bit hard to follow, but it seems like, you know, something, this ancient technology like exploded and took out the world, and then these giant robots started attacking, and like now there's this plague and weird disease.
It's actually a pretty common story in a lot of these games. I'm starting to wonder if maybe game developers know something that we don't about our future.
Yeah, maybe.
Should we be worried?
Well, if we start seeing giant robots, we'll know what to do.
Now, where is this game? Is this on Steam?
It's on Steam, yeah. Same. It's also on, I believe, PS4, Xbox 360, or Xbox One, I should say. I think it's coming to Switch as well. So it's a pretty big game. It came out last June, I want to say. It was a Kickstarter game, and it was, I think the initial goal was like $30,000, and it ended up getting like $600,000. So, like, it's going on, it went on to all these different consoles and everything.
Well, since our topic for today is challenge and difficulty in games, is this a Would you call this a difficult game?
I would say so, yeah. The combat is, you know, it's a top-down sort of Zelda game, and it's basically you're a character with a sword and a gun. And
oh, that's cheating.
You only get so many shots with the gun, so like it's you can shoot 6 bullets, and as you run out of bullets, if you use your sword to attack enemies, every time you hit an enemy with your sword, you get 1 bullet back, basically. It's like a laser gun, so it's like charging up your gun.
Okay, that makes sense.
So it's this cool balance between like making you shoot from afar and also getting up close and like saving your bullets for later or stuff like that. There's also a dash mechanic that lets you dash away from enemies or like dodge attacks and stuff like that. Mm. And that becomes... You got to have a lot of like twitch reflexes in order to make it through a lot of the boss fights and stuff like that. And, you know, a lot of combat encounters will basically just be this tiny little room with like 30 enemies that you have to make your way around. And it's kind of like a strategic combat system in a way. Mm-hmm. Not strategic in that it's you pause and have turns or whatever, but it's strategic in that you have to think about how you're approaching the enemies and, you know, saving up your bullets, stuff like that. So it's pretty interesting combat system. The game also does a really good job with exploration, I would say. There's lots of little secrets around the world.
Are you in an open world? Like, not open world's the wrong term.
Yeah.
Are you in a series of dungeons, like underground type spaces, or are you in open spaces looking for dungeons, sort of like Zelda, and then once you solve it, you come out?
Yeah, it's more like that. So there's this like hub central city in the middle of the map.
Oh, well, see, that's like Diablo.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Is it? Okay. I haven't played Diablo, so there you go.
Yeah, so Diablo, the original at least, and the other ones just had it in different zone, in different acts, but the original Diablo had one central city and then one dungeon and this just multiple levels. And were just descending into hell to face the devil, Diablo.
All right.
So there was, you would always go back to the town and you would warp back and forth. There was just one town and one dungeon that just kept going. Mm. It sounds like here there's one central town, but there's multiple dungeons in different locations.
Yeah. So basically the game works by, there's the central town and then there's a compass that goes north, south, east, west. And depending on which way you go, and you can choose any way, you know, kind of like an open world sort of thing. Each of those zones kind of acts as its own dungeon. And it's a very big, sprawling, like open area, but there's lots of little things to look for. And basically the way you beat the dungeons is you explore outside and inside the dungeons. And like, you know, one of them is like a ruined city, for example. So you have to go into buildings and go into stuff like that. And,
Was it just combat, or are there puzzle-solving elements as well?
There's a little bit of puzzle-solving, but it's not the same kind of puzzle-solving that you see in a Zelda game.
Okay.
There's, like, the first dungeon I did was one where there was a lot of enemies, and then there was, like, these moving bricks that would, like, smush you if you got in front of them, so you had to, like, time moving through them, that sort of thing. And then they added that plus combat, which made it a bigger challenge.
Okay, so instead of puzzles, they're just more like challenging rooms.
Yeah,
sort of thing.
I would say that. Yeah.
That's pretty cool. And then there are boss fights too in these dungeons.
Yeah, so basically what you do is when you get to one of those dungeons, there's four triangles that you have to find. They don't really give a name for them.
We call those the Triforce.
Yeah, except there's four of them, so it's the Quad Force, I guess.
Even better.
Yeah, so it's four right triangles, and then they become a square.
Why does Triforce sound so cool and Quad Force sound so fake? Like, it's just try hard?
Quad Force sounds like a G.I. Joe sort of show from the 90s.
This is the Quad Force! Oh, yeah, like a G.I. Joe ripoff?
Yeah.
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 But yeah, so you find the Quad Force.
Yeah, you find the Quad Force for each dungeon, and then you that unlocks... a boss fight that you then have to go to and then beat the boss. And I haven't played too far in, like I've beaten two of the bosses. And there's four dungeons as far as I can tell, but there might be more later. I don't know. But I've beaten two of the bosses, and basically after you beat four bosses, I guess there's going to be one last thing that you have to do, but I've only played for about 6 hours so far. So I'm not sure about that, but the way you beat these dungeons is basically all just through exploration, because the map that they give you is really not a, it's a good, it'll get you to where you need to go, but it doesn't give you enough details for you to navigate really. So you have to just like explore the rooms by yourself, and it can be really satisfying to like, you know, find your way through basically a big labyrinth and, find, you know, all these little secrets and items and keys and stuff like that to get from point A to point B, basically. So
cool.
It's a lot of fun.
Cool. Yeah. I definitely want to check it out. I remember that was on my radar, around the time it was on Kickstarter, and then it just kind of fell off just because of other games, took a while to make, and I didn't go back to it, but I need to.
Yeah.
So I will, especially since it's on PS4, I can actually play it.
Yeah.
Now it's time for Table Talk. Discussions on tabletop games of all kinds.
Okay, well, I have some table talk. So gather around the table, let's pour ourselves a nice glass of Chardonnay. So recently I've been playing introduced this new game to my role-playing group called Masks. And it is a Powered by the Apocalypse game. And I don't know if you're aware of this system.
I'm familiar with it, yeah. Okay. I've played a few Powered by Apocalypse games.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Really? So which ones have you played?
What's the one?
There's one, the one that's the most well-known is probably Apocalypse World, because that's where it gets its name. That introduced the system. The
I don't other think I've one played is that one.
Dungeon World. You may have played that one. That one's very well-known.
Unless I'm mistaken, I think there's this one called like Fellowship or something that's basically emulating the Fellowship of the Ring from Lord of the Rings.
I don't know, possibly.
Yeah.
But basically Powered by the Apocalypse is a system that's based more on storytelling, collaborative storytelling, and on relationships.
Yeah.
Particularly relationships between players. And so the GM of the game, a typical GM, doesn't quite have the same role. Really, the role for the GM is to kind of settle disputes between players in terms of whenever they actually do roll. But as the GM, you're never telling them when they roll. You're never actually telling them how things go. You let the players determine what happens based on roles. There's still a rule system, and it's actually very simple. It is a 2d6 game, and you do have stats, but they are flavored. So in Dungeon World, they're a little bit more traditional. In Masks, because it is a superhero game, and specifically superheroes, like young superheroes, you are a young team of superheroes like Teen Titans or Young Justice, the X-Men. You're a team that's of young heroes in a world of many, many older heroes, established heroes. And you're on a team and you're trying to find your place in the world, but also obviously go on, you know, super heroic missions, sort of thing.
So Powerpuff Girls, got it.
Definitely, like I said, that's why I specifically said Teen Titans, because the book even says these are our inspirations. So it's things like Teen Titans and Young Justice. Powerpuff Girls, not really. I think they're a little bit younger than the demographic. That, but it's interesting because all of us playing, we're all in our 30s. So we're playing 16, 15-year-olds, not 10-year-olds. Okay. But still, we're playing younger people, but it's interesting. And you have, it's a 2d6 system, like I was saying. So it's a 2d6 system, and if you roll above a 10, I believe it is, it's an automatic hit, and everything that you wanted to happen happens. And it's also with plus whatever stat is related to it. I'll get to stats in a second.
Oh, okay, so the stats are like modifiers to your roll.
Yes, they're modifier to your roll, but it's so 2d6. But if you roll a 7 to 9, you still hit, but there's consequences.
Right.
Which is a little bit, probably sounds a little familiar if you played Star Wars Edge of the Empire from Fantasy Flight. But that one's much more of a system that taps a narrative on top, and this is more of a narrative game that adds a system.
Yeah.
So, and then of course, if you get below that, if you get a 6 or below, and you fail, and your modifiers are both pluses and minuses. So sometimes you'll have it ranges from a -2 to a +3, and that's it.
Okay.
Those are the max range, and you're always going to have some that are high and some that are low. Your stats in the Masks game, they're called labels. And instead of being normal stats like strength or speed or agility, something like that, they're actually considered like the way that your character sees themselves in the world. So it's things like danger, like you see yourself as a danger, or you're willing to face danger, that kind of thing. Or freak, like you think of yourself as a freak of nature. Or mundane, you think of yourself as just a normal person that just happens to have powers, to use a few of the examples. So there's a standard set of moves that everybody has, and that's kind of like how you perform an action. So if you're doing an everyday normal thing you can do with your superpowers, like let's say you say, So I quickly, I, you know, I'm going to run, I have super speed. Let's say you have super speed, just one of the powers you could have.
Yeah.
And you, I'm going to run down, run to the corner store and get a chili dog and bring it back. Cause I think that's going to be funny for our group. There's no role for that. You have super speed. You can do that.
Right.
There's no reason for you to roll. There's no narrative reason for you to roll.
Yeah. That
the
makes
roles,
sense.
Right. The roles.
Cause why would you fail at getting a chili dog?
Of course. So in, unless there was supposed to be something that happens along the way, possibly,
right.
But otherwise there's no point. So the only way that the roles are supposed to come into play is when you don't know what's going to happen and I don't know what's going to happen. And as the GM, my role is to really to find out what happens,
right.
And to try to have a, try to, you know, tell a story based on what the players want to do.
Mm-hmm.
So another example of that. So a move might be something like, and they're very descriptive, like a story. So I think if I remember correctly, one of them is called directly engaging a threat. So that would be a move. Like, for example, if you are there's a bunch of, say, people like FBI special, like anti-hero task force or whatever,
yeah,
style people that break into, you know, a place, and they're coming after your team, and they all have, like, you know, weapons that might actually hurt you. So now if you want to, you know, attack them in some way or move through them in some way, you're directly engaging them. So you would roll in that situation.
Mm.
So it's, and you would roll because you don't know exactly what's going to happen, and neither do I. Whereas if they were just, say, random pawns or scrubs that you literally could, you would for sure win, I wouldn't even have you roll. I would just say, no, you take them all out. It's no problem because you're just, you're that good.
Yeah.
And the other thing that this game does that I think is interesting is the focus is not on how powerful your characters are. So
right.
They are, so each of the, art that you have different, playbooks is what they call them to pick your character class is a playbook.
Yeah.
And they basically are very specific roles in the story. So no one can play the same role. And they're all based on different characters in like Teen Titans or Young Justice or these sort of like stories, X-Men.
Right.
So the concept here is that some of them are much more powerful than others. Like one of them called the Beacon is more of a kind of a lighthearted hero that's kind of just happy to be there sort of person who has very minor powers, or if no powers at all, like maybe they just have, you know, a bow and arrow or something for gears and like trick arrows, or maybe they have minor teleportation abilities or something. But another character might be the Nova, which is considered to have a very powerful ability that is so dangerous that whenever they use it, it could cause a lot of collateral damage. So they're always very careful to use their power.
Okay.
Or the Doomed, that every time they use their abilities, they bring themselves closer to their death. So it's supposed to be, the tension is supposed to be created in more the way that you use your powers and how you discover who you are. And then of course your relationships with other players, because you're expected to, have influence. Some players have influence over you or you have influence over them.
Yeah.
So it's very, and that gives you advantages on roles and things like that. And it's very much a game that's about relationships and storytelling and not a game about stats.
Yeah.
Or
and,
loot.
And now that you mentioned the character roles, thing, I looked it up and the Fellowship game that I was talking about a little bit earlier was powered by the Apocalypse.
Oh, it was.
Yeah. So it was basically like, you are going on this journey as this group, and you've got the roles of like, oh, you've got the Hobbit type character, or you've got like the Gandalf type character, you know, the wise wizard who
mm-hmm.
leads the group. So yeah, I can see that working. And this is definitely the kind of, RPG game that I like. It's, you know, Fate and, stuff like that. Apocalypse settings. Those are interesting to me. The more story driven stuff, character driven stuff, mm-hmm. as opposed to, you know, rolling to see if you can open up a chest, even though you have a lock picking skill of however.
Right, right. Well, and one of the interesting things about this game is a very big shift for my group, because we've been playing D&D 5e,
yeah.
Which I do think is a good addition. By the way, I'm not down on 5e at all. I think it's the best D&D addition in quite a while.
Okay.
That being said, it, of course, it's very specific for it what it does well,
yeah.
But it is definitely a stat heavy system. And even though they have, it's not as role heavy as say AD&D was back in the day, like, you know, two, it's still you still have to roll a lot. You still have to roll the time.
Yeah.
It's still one of those games where you miss a lot. One of the things that I like about, Masks is that when you roll and miss, you actually get to mark your potential, which is the way you level up.
Right.
So you always feel like you're moving. There's forward momentum mm-hmm. in the game. So that was a shift. The other shift was the recognition that you can do kind of whatever you want. And there's that extra element of, you know, the GM really doesn't have much authority aside from just helping facilitate the game. So it's much more of the GM's helping you tell the story as opposed to the GM is setting up challenges. It doesn't feel that way. It feels more collaborative, even though I do create villains and things like that.
Yeah.
So it's definitely a shift from another type of game, but I would recommend it if you do have a gaming group and you want to try. And I wouldn't necessarily say that, because I'm not sure we're going to continue our games with the mask system per se. Mm. We might switch over to something a little bit closer to what we're used to, like Dungeon World, which is more of a traditional fantasy tropes,
right.
but using the same system essentially.
Yeah. And so we might cool switch to that. Is that it's got all of these different settings.
Yes. Stuff. One of the things that is not cool is that it's actually kind of hard to find their books.
Mm.
I noticed this. I went online. I tried to find the original Apocalypse World book. You can find it digitally, but I actually like having the physical versions of RPG
right.
books.
Yeah.
And honestly, I kind of collect them. I have some that I have never even played. It's kind of weird. I just like looking at them. And they're beautiful books. I mean, I've seen the Mask book is beautiful. It's got great artwork. It's put together really well. Couldn't find a book. I just couldn't find it. I think you can order it from their site, maybe, but I tried to go to... I went to Madness, for example, around here, around us. Nothing. Not even a single book from not Dungeon World either.
Wow.
In fact, the only one that I could even find on Amazon, actually, I think it was actually eBay, not even Amazon, was Dungeon World for a decent price. Apocalypse World, because apparently it's not even in print, you have to pay like $150 for the book or something like
that. Yeah, well, isn't it like a kind of a small self-published sort of thing?
It was initially, yeah. I just find it interesting that the original book that kind of spawned all of these different settings.
Iterations of it.
Thank you. That use the same system. They're still, you can find those, but the original is out of print. It's kind of an odd situation.
Yeah, that's weird.
But yeah, I mean, well, you know, it seems like they're, if you can find one of the books, great. Otherwise, they're easy to find, you know, digitally. I think it's, and I mean, you know, buying them like Drive-Thru RPG, I think is where I got mine.
Yeah.
That sells things digitally. I'm certainly not advocating people just download things illegally. But we live in this great digital age where we can find actual, you know, digital books and ebooks
right.
and we can purchase them and relatively cheaply. And it's not as fun as having the actual physical book, but it's something. That's Masks, powered by the Apocalypse.
Yeah. So if you want to find that, that's apocalypse-world.com. I think from there you can buy hardcover books and you can buy PDFs, that sort of thing. So
cool. Fantastic.
This is the Gaming Meta. News and commentary about the games industry and gamer culture.
There's been a recent announcement about the new Assassin's Creed game, and it's a little unfortunate that Doc is not here to talk about this because I know he is the resident Assassin's Creed fanboy on our podcast.
Right.
So I'm sure hopefully he will listen to this with bated breath.
He'll have a back talk for us next time around.
I hope so, and I'm kind of curious to see his opinion on this, but too bad you get our opinions instead.
The two least qualified people, because we've never, I don't think either of us have played Assassin's Creed in years.
Yeah, I've played 1 and 2 and parts of 3, but I just lost interest in the series, to be honest with you.
Yeah, I loved this series up until 3, actually.
It's kind of how I was. I thought the first one had a lot of promise,
mm-hmm.
and then the second one I felt built on the first, and I really liked it, and I'm like, okay, I'm excited to see where it goes, and then it just went completely where I didn't want it to go. I just didn't care. It just felt like it became a... yearly release where nothing's really being added that's that interesting, and it's just like they're spinning their wheels. There's no real innovation to the series, in my opinion. Well, guess what? That's all about to change, because there is now innovation, or is there?
Oh, boy.
So in the new Assassin's Creed, it's called Assassin's Creed Origins, and one of the things they do well is they do create historical regions, and they try to create them in such a way that they might be interesting to look at or explore.
Yeah, that's the one thing I really like about Assassin's Creed in general.
Sure.
I played Black Flag a little bit, and I got to the point where you can actually get to the open world and explore,
mm-hmm.
and I never did any quests after that, because it took me like 4 hours to get to that point, because there were so many stupid tutorials.
That is ridiculous.
Yeah.
But
4 hours is probably exaggerating, but still, it was a long time.
But yeah, that is one of the appeals of the game, is that exploration concept and being inside this world and having these experiences within the world, these challenges and combat and etc. Well, in the new Assassin's Creed Origins, which takes place in ancient Egypt, which is actually a really interesting period in history, in my opinion, one of the ones that I always find the most interesting.
Yeah.
But they've added a new mode called Discovery Tour Mode.
What does that pray tell?
Well, I thought it was kind of an odd name for it too, but essentially it's a mode where you can, it almost feels like a debugging mode, but it's basically you get to explore the world that they have created without any combat, without any story, without any challenges, any missions. It's just, you're exploring the pretty world that they made. That's it.
Well, if it's just an alternate game mode, I can... Well,
it's not a game mode at all. That's kind of the point I was making. It's not a game mode at all.
What is it?
It's not a game.
Oh, well...
It's a mode in a game.
Well, is it a thing where you can, like, go into the main menu and just explore the world and then go back to your main game? Because, I mean, it just seems like a kind of a neat feature.
Yeah, it's a completely different thing.
Yeah.
I just... The reason that I bring it up, because, I think it's just... Honestly, I think it's pointless. Okay. I feel like it just wastes time from the developers could have spent time elsewhere, in my opinion.
I feel like it would
mainly because it's not a game. This is not a game. This is just you're exploring an environment. Okay, great. That's something. That's not a game.
Yeah. So, I feel like it would be better if it was like a PC game where you could just turn on God mode and explore. You know, you might as well just do that as opposed to making it a new game mode.
Yeah, I part of it that kind of annoys me is that it feels like it's being added so that people that can't play the game can still experience parts of it.
Right.
And I don't understand why you feel the need to accommodate people that can't play the game.
Especially since there's difficulty sliders that make it like stupid easy.
Sure. It would be like, it's like the equivalent of Cliff Notes, I guess, in a way. You're reading a book. You're simply not intellectually, and I don't mean for people that are skipping the book and reading the Cliff Notes.
Right.
I mean people that literally lack the capacity to understand the book. Like they read it, it just goes in one ear, you know, in one ear somehow because they're reading it out loud. I don't know. But regardless, like they read the book, they don't understand it. So they get the Cliff Notes to help them understand what they've read.
Right.
It's, in other words, it's sort of like a cheat for people that can't really appreciate the art for what it is,
but still want to have the sort of experience about with
it. Sure, but it's like a dumbed down experience,
right?
So that's kind of the point that I was making.
Not and that you can dumb down Assassin's Creed that much.
Sure,
more,
that's and hey, that's a great point too.
Maybe I'm just saying that because the only thing that's interesting about Assassin's mm-hmm. Creed to me is the exploration. So a mode with just the exploration could be fun.
It would be really boring.
Yeah,
because it'd be one thing if it was just okay, I'm exploring. And it's not really part of the story, but there's still combat and side quests. Like, right. For example, in The Witcher 3.
Oh, so there's not even any side quests.
No, it's nothing. It's literally you're just exploring.
Are there, like, NPCs?
I think there's NPCs you can talk to, from what I understood, but they don't do anything. And there's no challenges. It's a no challenge mode.
Okay.
Like, no challenge, no combat, no story, no anything.
I see what you mean by debug now.
Yeah, it feels like a debug mode, right?
That's weird.
The reason I bring this up, one of the reasons I bring this up, is not just to talk a little bit about it and kind of bash it a bit, but also because there was actually a lot of excitement, oddly enough, among a lot of common game journalism sites that, you know, websites that seem to be excited for this mode. Like, oh, this is great. This is finally we get to explore a game, blah, 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 which is not really a game. And yet, around the same time, Cuphead came out, which we'll talk a little bit when we get into our difficulty challenge discussion later.
Right.
It's an interesting game that's with artwork that looks like a 1930s cartoon,
right.
But it's a platformer and a pretty challenging one, actually. I have not had the chance to play it yet. I really want to, but I don't have the system that can play it, but I will, just have not had the opportunity. Hmm. But it's a really interesting game that I've heard a lot of great things about. However, it was getting a lot of flack from the same people that are celebrating Discovery Tour Mode, saying that, well, Cuphead is too difficult and it's too challenging, and there should be more of an easy mode, which there actually is an easy mode, but easy mode doesn't let you see one of the bosses. Oh no. Oh, and really? Then another one of the criticisms was we need to have a game mode to skip all the boss fights because they're too hard.
The game is about the bosses.
I know. The game, it is basically a boss rush is what the game is. You can't skip the bosses.
So why would you want to, wait, you're just basically removing half the game.
If you are so terrible at a game that you can't play through it, just watch a Let's Play.
Yeah.
And that's kind of what I was getting to with Discovery Tour mode as well. If you're so interested in the game world of Assassin's Creed Origins but have no interest in playing the game, watch a Let's Play.
Yeah, I mean, it's not quite the same thing because
it's not the same. The game mode is about
exploration.
Sure, but I would never say that a Let's Play is the same as playing a game.
Right.
It's totally not.
Well,
however, you can still experience secondhand.
You would get a more full experience watching a Let's Play of Cuphead than you would watching a Let's Play of Assassin's Creed, I would say. Because with Assassin's Creed, you actually go and explore for yourself, and that's kind of a more, you know, personal experience. Whereas with Cuphead, it's a, you know, a linear platformer with combat.
And I still think it's a very personal experience. I think that the act of playing a game is inherently personal.
I agree.
And it's an experience that you can't necessarily have. Like, you're not gonna have the same experience that I do playing a game. You'll have a similar experience, but not the same experience.
Right.
I know what you're talking about with the exploration, but I'm comparing it more to the Discovery Tour mode in which all the other game elements are stripped away. You probably want to still see the story. You're probably still interested in what's going on in the story. You're probably still interested in the fights, even if you feel like you can't do them. That's why I mentioned the Let's Play part.
Right.
Regardless, I just can't understand why gameplay in one sense in Cuphead is being sort of bashed. Like, uh-oh, this game has too much gameplay. It's too difficult for us.
Too much gameplay,
apparently.
This is a video game.
And then another game that had all the gameplay stripped away, that's apparently a good thing. So it just feels a little at odds with me for someone that is supposed to be a gamer or people that are reported on video games.
Well, wasn't there this journalist who got bashed for not even being able to complete the tutorial?
Yes.
For Cuphead?
Yes, there was, actually. So his name was Dean Takahashi, who worked for VentureBeat, or still does. And he's been covering games for 18 years. He's been a tech journalist for 25 years. And he essentially failed in the Cuphead tutorial multiple times. It took him 2 solid minutes to even get past the first jump, which is how terrible he was at the game.
Yeah.
And he rightfully so got mocked for his poor performance. And then there was, of course, the backlash of, oh, it's harassment, blah, blah, blah. It's just the internet. If you are bad at something, people are going to point it out. That's not really harassment. That's just...
Well, I mean, you're also a games journalist who's been doing this for 18 years.
Right.
You should know how to beat a tutorial.
Yeah, I think that's another issue that maybe we can talk about another time. The another thing that I have issue with is that there are definitely people that are writing about games that are not actually gamers.
Yeah.
They just write about games. And why are they writing about games? Because they wish they could be writing about something else and they couldn't get into that field. So they're writing about games as a fallback.
And to be fair, I don't know anything about Dave Takahashi except...
I know that he's terrible at video games. That much I know. Well, so now that I know that, I know that he clearly falls into that category. But but again, I mean, if he wants to write about games from a different perspective, that's fine. But if you're going to put yourself out there and play and have it recorded, yourself playing through a tutorial of a game, you probably shouldn't be doing that unless you're actually at least decent at playing video games.
Right.
Kind of going out on a limb with that statement, I guess. But well, that's all I'll say about that.
This is the Mobile Minute, where we share something new or noteworthy about those computers we keep in our pants.
I'm going to talk a bit about Chroma Squad. It is a game that that came out 2 years ago, and I just downloaded it recently. I have a new phone. I wanted to try out some games, and it's actually only $5, so I think it was a pretty good purchase. It's a tactical role-playing game.
Ooh.
But it's a tactical role-playing game. Now get this. Here's the part that actually kind of made me buy in. It's about Super Sentai characters.
Ooh.
And not only that, but it's about you. You're not actually, you are actors. You're Super Sentai actors who decide to form their own studio to create their own episodes of a new show. And if you are not aware of what Super Sentai is, it's essentially Power Rangers. It's what we know here as Power Rangers.
Yeah.
So it's actually developed by a Brazilian team known as Behold Studios. And when they developed it, they did it because they have so much love for the Super Sentai and Power Rangers that they created this game as sort of like a parody of it. And they actually got a cease and desist letter from Saban, who owns the rights to the Power Rangers, which is all the Japanese footage of Super Sentai, and they develop it into American version. which I found hilarious, but they were able to get out of the pending litigation by adding "inspired by Saban's Power Rangers" underneath the title "Chroma Squad." That's all they had to do, which clearly it was, but it seemed kind of petty. And yeah. If you know anything about Power Rangers, and I am an unabashed fanboy of this absurdly campy, childish thing, right, just because I think it's hilarious. But you really have to like cheesy stuff to like it. And this, the game itself plays that up. So the idea is that you are a group of Super Sentai or Power Ranger type actors, mm-hmm, known as the Chroma Squad, basically that's the name.
Yeah.
And you are working at a studio with this other director known as Dr. Soap or Director Soap. Maybe he's meant to be director. I'm not sure. I just call him Dr. Soap. It sounds more sinister. He's your director, and he's trying, and that's the short tutorial teaching you how to use your teamwork moves and beat up the bad guys and stuff like that to kind of show how it goes, because he's telling you what to do. You get fed up with his direction, and you decide to go form your own company. You leave, basically. And from there, you form your own company, but there's this implication that he's going to come back and at some point try to stop you. So he's kind of like the main antagonist.
Yeah. But
then there's also the element of you have to create all of your episodes. You have to create the costumes for your characters. You get to build your giant robot characters and the monsters and things like that. And your enemies, and you have budgets for each of your shows. And you have to, once the fights are starting, you have to control the characters in the fights and make it exciting for the viewer.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, and you get to build your, like, after that tutorial part, you get to build your cast of Rangers. I only have 5 so far. I don't know if there's going to be the sixth one or more.
Right.
But so far, I just have 5. You get to pick all their colors.
And you said you get to control the enemies in the fights?
No.
Oh, okay.
No. But you get to, like, create the direction of the episodes.
Okay.
So it's like there's two parts to it. There's the tactical part when you're in the battles, mm-hmm, and then there's the part of building and creating the episodes. So, okay, like, for example, the first mission that you have, and it's divided into seasons, like seasons of your show.
Right.
Yeah. And so the first season, it's like, okay, create 4 episodes of your show and a season finale. And you have to stay within budget, and you have to gain an audience. If you fail to gain an audience, and if you fail to stay within budget, you get a game over. It's that simple. Huh. And so okay, you just continue with new seasons. You unlock more and more moves for your characters in new seasons. And it's actually really interesting. Each character has their own style. Like, normally a lot of it is set by color, which is very similar to how Super Sentai and Power Rangers is set up, but you can change the color to anything you want. Like, mm-hmm, for example, you could make if the leader of the team by default is red, because that's traditional, but you can make it any color within the spectrum they give you, which is pretty wide.
Okay.
And the same thing, you can also change who is behind the suit. So you have all these different options. They all have different stats, and they also look different. So it could be, I think I picked a very basic, common characters for all of them, because I tried to keep it within theme, and I kept the basic color palette, because that's what I like. But each of the different characters are not just a red, blue, green, pink, whatever. They actually have specializations. So they're considered like the assault type, or the scout type, or the leader type, the support type. So they all have their own type, and you can assign it the traditional color or any color you want. And then you also give the character behind it. You can change that at different points. Obviously, these are not just people behind the masks. These are also actors that you're paying. So they have a salary. So there's that element of it too, because the people that the implication is that the people that you're paying, that you are controlling rather as the, in the fights, those are the stunt people. They're not necessarily the actors that are behind the suit that you have to pay to play them on TV.
Mm-hmm.
So there's that element. You start with a low budget and you go up, but it's an interesting game, and I'm actually enjoying it.
So it's a tactical RPG crossed with a sim sort of tycoon game.
Yes, exactly.
And I love tycoon games, and I love tactical RPGs. So
and it does also have a retro aesthetic as well. Okay.
Oh, like the 8-bit sort of?
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
yeah. Cool. It kind of reminds me of, it's definitely not 8-bit. It's more like...
Well, pixel art.
It's more like, it's more like the Hyper Light Drifter type thing, where it's pixel art. It's clearly a retro aesthetic, but it's not really one that would fit neatly into any system of the past.
Okay.
But it's worth checking out.
And now, this week's meaty topic of discussion.
We we're gonna talk a little bit about the relationship between challenge and fun. And I think this kind of goes into some of the games that we have been talking about today. Hyper Light Drifter, you said, was challenging. I know Cuphead is a real challenging game.
Very challenging.
Discovery Tour mode of Assassin's Creed Origin. Where would you rate that challenge?
That seems really hard.
It's really, really hard. Yeah. I'm gonna go with a big zero on that one. Just no challenge at all. And then Chroma Squad, I would not say is hard, but it does have difficulty levels. And I think that's one thing that we can talk about in this discussion too, is not just the difficulty of a game, but also this new thing of difficulty levels. And I say new, it's not really new, but it's relatively new in the sense of video games for a long while didn't have difficulty. Back in an arcade, you didn't have a difficulty level for the most part. Very rarely you would have a difficulty in an arcade in the 80s. Mm. And in early video games, like on the Nintendo, for example, sure, sometimes you would have two modes, like normal and hard, maybe.
Yeah.
And that was it at most.
I can't think of any specific examples of that for sure.
It's been a while. I know there's a few of them that existed, but those were the max that you would get. And sometimes it would be a situation where the hard mode was built into the game. Like, for example, the original Legend of Zelda, it had the second quest that you could play through. And the second quest, and I've played through both of them, and the original Zelda is actually sometimes underrated in terms of even its difficulty. I wouldn't call it a really hard game, but for a modern gamer, it might be somewhat of a challenge.
I think it's pretty difficult, yeah.
The second quest, that's a hard freaking game. I mean, it is one of the harder games on the system, and I think it doesn't always get as much credit for that.
I have yet to do the second quest yet.
It's tough. I mean, it really is tough. You get thrown into it, get thrown into some pretty tough challenges right away. But that, of course, that was an optional type thing. Well, nowadays, games, we take it for granted that they're built in with difficulty levels and difficulty settings. So, I don't know. I mean, you kind of proposed this topic initially, Nick, or parts of it. Yeah. What are your thoughts on difficulty or challenge, I guess we're going to call it? Because difficulty is more subjective. I think challenge is a little bit more what we're going for, right? Because that feels like if I say a game is difficult, it feels like I'm making a statement.
Yeah.
But if I'm talking about challenge, that's a personal thing. Like a game, am I being challenged in this game?
Well, right? Yeah. I mean, I think any game needs some degree of challenge. For it to be a game.
I agree. I think that games need some level of challenge. And part of that, I think, goes into what makes a game enjoyable, what makes a game fun. And when you beat a game, or not necessarily even beat the game, but when you advance to a certain part in the game, or you complete, say you beat a boss, or you complete a stage, or what have you, whatever that milestone is, whatever that marker is where you know I've accomplished something, how do you know that you accomplished something? I mean, aside from the game telling you, like, good job, there was some challenge, right? Like, it presents you with a challenge, and you beat the challenge, and you go, whoa, I'm cool. I did something great, right? Because that's what we want in video games. I mean, they're very much a... I'm speaking a little bit generally. Maybe some people might disagree, but I know that's something that I know I want, and I believe you want, too, and I feel like most gamers typically do want to have some sense of accomplishment when they play through a game.
I mean, in order to even stay engaged with the game, you need to have, at the very least, like, goals to accomplish, whether or not they're particularly difficult. You just need to be doing something.
Yeah.
You can't just, I mean, the Assassin's Creed wandering around the world mode, that's, you know, it might appeal to some people who all they want to do is explore, but even then, like, exploration games, they give you goals.
Right.
They give you reasons to want to explore.
And with Discovery Tour mode, that to me feels like you might be interested in it on some level intellectually, like you would if you were, say, reading about ancient Egypt. It's not a game. You're not really being challenged. You're just learning information, right?
So it's like an interface for for reading text dialogue.
That's what it feels like to me, or at least you're getting to see something. Instead of reading the description of a space or seeing a picture of a space, you get to walk around that space.
Right.
And there's some interest there. I'm not going to say there's not.
But it's not a game.
But it's also not a challenge, is the other part of it. It's not a challenge. So I do want to talk a bit about flow theory, because Doc isn't here to bring that academia element to our show. So I'll go ahead and do it, and I'll stick back on my, academic hat, and, I do actually have an academic background as well. Surprisingly, it's a shock, I know.
I have none, so it's going to be a little bit unbalanced here.
Well, so I want to talk a bit about flow theory, or specifically cognitive flow. And this has been something that's been examined in video game design for several years now. But originally, it started with a Hungarian psychologist, and I'm probably going to butcher his name, but I'm going to try. Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi. Is that correct? Close enough?
Let's see what Google Translate says.
Okay.
Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi.
Not bad.
Pretty close.
Not bad. Well, Csikszentmihalyi, he developed this theory of what he called flow, or what some of us think of as being in the zone, right?
Right.
So the idea here is you are performing an activity and you become so immersed within that activity that you're feeling completely involved, completely inside, you know, just you block everything else out and you have this, you know, deep sense of enjoyment and focus. And you start to, you don't really notice what's happening around you, that kind of thing.
Right.
Athletes talk about this too. This has actually been studied a lot in athletics. Mm. And that's when it's more often called the zone as well.
Right.
Or sometimes it's called the athlete got hot. You hear that sometimes in sports, okay. Right? Like, oh, wow, he's really hot. He keeps, you know, like in basketball, they're hitting every shot or
okay.
something.
Yeah.
You know, or like in football, you'll say like that guy's got a hot hand and he just, everything that he, every play that you, time
he's,
you give him the ball, he runs it. Yeah. So it's on a roll kind of
yeah.
thing. And it's when, and the commentators may not necessarily know that's what's going on, but an athlete will talk about, anyone that's done even, you know, just amateur athletics or something might have experienced the same thing. Or in a video game where you feel so connected to what you're doing that everything just clicks. And you're intensely focused, you're into it, and you're really enjoying yourself, and everything just works for you. And that's kind of what it means to be in cognitive flow.
Right.
Well, this was, and of course this has been going on long before it had been given a name. So the concept here, when it gets into game theory itself, is to sort of look at this equilibrium between skill and difficulty. So that's kind of how you can get into this, what they call the flow state.
Yeah.
So you have to have, and it's different for everyone. It's part of the challenge here for game designers as well.
Right.
So if you have too much skill in something and the difficulty doesn't match that skill,
then you're just going to plow through everything.
And it's going to be boring.
Yeah.
And you might initially enjoy that feeling of, oh, I'm awesome at this. I'm great. But if there's no challenge, because your skill is so high and the difficulty is so low and you don't feel any sort of challenge, you're not going to get into flow state. It's going to be boring. But the reverse is also true. If it's really difficult and your skill level is not up to par, you're going to get frustrated. It's going to be very hard for you to stay engaged because it's just going to make you angry. You're not going to feel like you can do it.
Right.
And so there's this balancing act, this equilibrium that has to be found. And mm-hmm. I'm sure part of that, part of the reason why we have difficulty levels is to try to get more people, and it may not have even thought of it as being flow state at this point, yeah. but this idea of we want people to play a game and experience enjoyment and in overcoming challenges, regardless of their skill level, is a general idea.
Yeah.
Now, games require skill just by the nature of what they are. So there's a level of that within there. So, I mean, what do you think about this concept of trying to get into flow? I mean, is it even something that we can do because it's so personal?
Yeah.
Or is it just we just approximate it with difficulty levels and that's about as far as we can go?
I think really the best thing you can do is approximate it, but difficulty levels and like difficulty sliders, you know, easy, medium, hard mode, maybe aren't the best way to do that. Maybe you should just make the game in such a way that it is challenging, but it's also easy to learn and it's easy for you to get better at the game rather than you having to basically just face an unfair challenge.
Hey, I like that you say learn because that's also been studied a lot too in game theory as well.
Mm-hmm.
This concept of we are the most interested in the game as we're learning its systems.
Exactly.
And the more that we learn, the more interested we become. But the moment that we feel like we've mastered those systems and there's nothing else for us to learn, then it gets boring again. So at that point, the game should introduce a new skill, something new for you to learn.
Yeah.
Like, for example, if you were playing, to use Mario as an example, first you learn how to move back and forth on the screen. Then you learn how to jump. You see a Goomba come by, he's going to hit you. You learn to jump.
Mm-hmm.
And not only do you learn to jump, but you learn if you fall on that Goomba, it stomps the Goomba and he dies.
Mm-hmm.
And you also learn, oh, if I jump on a box or a block rather, I could get a coin or some other power up.
Right.
So you learn new things. And in later Mario games, they introduce other little tricks. Like you can learn how to do a slide. You can learn how to wall jump. You can learn how to fly by flicking your raccoon tail when you're in raccoon form, say in Super Mario 3. So there's all these little things that you can learn and you can do. And if you've developed your game, if you've designed your game well enough, by the time the user has mastered all of those skills, they should be around the last level. And they should feel like, now I'm a master, I'm going to complete these last few challenges, because you still want to have that moment of feeling like you've mastered the game, and then you have to prove it by beating the final challenges. But if you've mastered all the game has to offer and you're only halfway through the game, you're probably going to lose interest before you ever beat it.
Right.
Has that experience ever happened to you in gaming?
None that I can think of specifically, but I feel like I have had that experience before. I just don't know with what game.
Well, I would say with games for me, like Skyrim, I think is a really good example, where I know that they try to do some scaling with the way that the enemies reacted to you, like their difficulty, but you can get to a point where the giants and the mammoths and the dragons are no longer a challenge.
Right.
And at that point, nothing in the game is a challenge. And so if you're still playing, you're not really even playing for the challenge at that point. You're just playing because you kind of like exploring the world itself, right? And maybe you like some of the side quests, maybe you're interested in the story, but then when it comes to the gameplay aspect, the actual challenge of the game, that's gone. And I feel that has happened to me before, and that's why I sometimes quit those type of games. That's probably one of the better examples of it. I think other games that do this, I think, well, a lot of old arcade games, without even really knowing it, like, for example, like run-and-gun type games or shooters, games like Gradius, Life Force, Ikaruga, or run-and-guns like Contra, Super Contra.
Well, any game that has, like, really simple mechanics that you can learn quickly, but then also has you put into different situations and then you have to adapt.
Yes. And then also gives you possibly different things that you can learn. Like in Contra, you had multiple types of shots, right? And obviously at a certain point you realize that spread is the best and you just use spread all the time and it's a little overpowered. But like you get to learn all these different shots and they were supposed to be situational. Same thing with the game like Life Force. You had all these different power-ups you could get, and for certain areas it'd be better to use one or the other, and you had to kind of learn this as you go.
Yeah.
You would be encountered with new enemies, and a lot of that wasn't even about how, like you were saying, adapting. It wasn't even about how you are necessarily learning new skills. You always kind of had those skills, but you're learning how they apply in this new situation.
I think
for me, a game that I think it is almost probably the best of any game because it was so clever at it. Have you played Donkey Kong on the Game Boy?
I have not.
So the reason I bring it up is because the game, when you first start it, it seems like an arcade port of the original Donkey Kong. So it's the exact same first few levels.
I have played that Donkey Kong.
Yes, and most people have. It's a classic. And if you haven't, please turn the show off and go play it. But Donkey Kong for the Game Boy is one of my all-time favorite games. And one of the reasons is when you first buy that game, you think, oh, I just bought Donkey Kong and I can play it on my Game Boy.
Right.
No. After the first few levels, suddenly you play, they're all the same four levels that you get in the arcade. But instead of repeating it on a loop like it does in the arcade with greater and greater speed, difficulty, that kind of thing, no, DK gets back up. Donkey Kong gets back up. I'm so close with him, I just call him DK. He gets up. He takes, you know, Pauline off again, kidnaps her again. And then suddenly you're on a mini map, like Super Mario Bros. 3 style. And you're in the city. And you learn that this is world 1-1.
So then you're about to go do a bunch of new
levels. And there are a ton of levels.
So rather than memorizing that stage, you have to go learn the new mechanics for each stage that you...
Yes. Okay. And the game teaches you the mechanics really cleverly by a lot of times by putting you in against enemies that either demo what you're supposed to do, like they'll do it and then you kind of learn, oh, I can kind of do that too. Or they kind of force you to use the new trick in order to beat those enemies.
Right.
Or sometimes between levels, they'll show Mario pull a trick off and you'll go, how did he do that? I wonder if I can do that. And then the very next level, you can. You just didn't know you could. And the best trick that game pulled was that you never unlock moves. From the very first time you play the game, you have every single move that Mario knows.
Yeah.
You just don't know you do. And that's fun because if you know that you can do, like, for example, you're so much more agile in this game than you are in the original game. You can do things like you can jump up in the air and you can walk on your hands. And when you walk on your hands and your feet are in the air, if DK throws a barrel at you, you can catch the barrel on your feet. You can kick it back at him. And you can jump, and you can do upside. Once you're also on your hands, you can do a super jump, and you can time it and do a jump flip and go much higher in the air.
But you just never need to do that in the first couple of levels, right?
You certainly don't need to, but you can.
Right.
And if you know that, and there's some really cool GIFs of this that I found online as well, just because it looks fun. But if you know all of the moves that Mario can technically do right in that first level, you can beat the first stage of Donkey Kong in about 1 second. Literally. Huh. Because you just go, you know, jump, do the hand walk, and then do super jump, super jump, super jump, super jump. You're at the top. That's it. It's that quick. It's like a 1.5 second GIF that you can find really easily. And I just think that's so brilliant that they give you all the moves and they don't feel like, well, what will the gamer do if they find all this out right away? They'll lose interest. Well, they won't, because there's actually so much that you can do that you just don't know you can do. Wall jumping is nothing. Obviously, well, there's no need to wall jump in that first stage. There's no walls to jump off, but using that as an example. So that's one approach, is to give you all these tools, just not let you know that you have them. The other approach, obviously, is that you learn more as you play. You gain more abilities, like Metroid does this very well. You unlock abilities as you go. This is a very common RPG convention.
Right. Well, one example I was thinking of, again, to come back to Hyper Light Drifter.
Sure.
Your only moves in that game are sword attack, dash out of the way, or dash towards enemies or whatever, and shoot your gun. Granted, you do get a few new guns as you beat stages. Like you can get like a shotgun type of thing, or like a laser gun that does more damage. But other than that, it's like basically the same mechanics forever. But what changes isn't what you're doing. What changes is the enemies that you're fighting, their tactics, and then combinations of enemies that you've already fought before. So, you know, there'll be the kind of enemies that swoop down and you have to hit them with a certain amount of timing. And then you learn that in an isolated setting. And then there's the enemies that shoot lasers at you. And then you have to fight one of those. And then you have to fight both of those at the same time, so that you have to strategize, you know, okay, this guy's going to fly down towards me, so I have to hit him right at the right moment. And then I have to dodge that guy's laser, because while I'm waiting for him, he's going to be charging his shot at me, that sort of thing. So it's more about the situational aspect of it, where, you know, simple mechanics for every character, including yourself, but the combinations introduce different strategies and stuff like that.
And I know you mentioned that you have to charge up your bullets by hitting an enemy with a sword.
Yes.
So I assume one of the strategies might be you would exhaust your bullets, try to run up and whack an enemy a few times so you can get more bullets, and then move back and you could shoot again.
Yeah.
That might be one strategy you could employ against an enemy that's really dangerous that you don't want to engage close up for too long.
Right. For example, there's a boss fight at the end of one of the stages that's basically it's a big boss and he does a lot of moves, but one of the things he does is he summons other enemies towards you. So what I do, and like those enemies can really do a lot of damage to you quickly. So what I did with that boss was I would just hit him several times with my sword and then go attack the smaller enemies with my gun so I could focus on him, because he took a lot of hits, that sort of thing.
So you wouldn't have to like disengage from him.
Right.
You could just shoot the other enemies from far away.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
But the other alternative, I guess, could be that you use those enemies as charging up your gun, so you don't even have to fight him, but that would be a slower but maybe safer strategy.
Mm-hmm. And that's a good example too of they're presenting you with this challenge of you're against this boss. It has a lot of HP. He's sending these small, you know, peons against you that'll do damage if you don't do something to them, but they're going to be much easier to kill. Mm-hmm. So you have to develop your own strategy of how am I going to take this boss down without taking too much damage from these peons? I can't ignore them completely. So, I mean, that's a good example of presenting you with that challenge, and you have to use your whole tool set of all the moves that you've learned in the game.
Of which there's only three or four.
Sure, but there's different ways that you can use them and strategize. Like you say, I mean, it's so simple. It sounds so simple, rather, but I'm sure it's a lot more difficult than practice. And maybe there's an element of that where I do feel that, at least in my experience with games, and speaking of flow theory in particular, this is something that I completely believe in, because I've experienced it myself. Like I have been in these states before.
Right.
And I don't know if you have.
Oh, for sure. Okay, yeah.
So it's that it's something that is in some ways, like sometimes you may not be able to describe it as well to someone else, but you know that you've been, when you've been in it, everything works, everything clicks, and it feels great because you feel like you're mastering what's happening. And yet it's not like it's not a challenge. It's still a challenge in the sense that
you have to stay fully engaged.
Yeah, you have to stay focused and engaged with what's going on. But you're able to succeed because your skill level is perfectly matched. You know, you're in that you've found that equilibrium,
right?
Basically. So, kind of getting on difficulty levels. Let me ask you this: this is something I've been thinking about for a while, and I've kind of bashed the idea that of Skyrim using, and Oblivion, I think did it. I think worse. I mean, you correct me if I'm wrong, because you're more of an Elder Scrolls fan than I am. But this concept of the enemies leveling up with you.
Oh yeah, Oblivion did it way worse.
There we go. Thank you. So
horribly.
And I've bashed that before, but I actually kind of wonder if maybe that's not the right direction to go when it comes to flow theory. Maybe instead of them leveling up with you in more of a strict RPG term, because then it always feels like everything's the same. You never really hit that flow. Everything's just the samey.
Well, with Oblivion, what happens is that there's these big difficulty spikes.
Yeah.
So basically the scaling isn't like you're now a level 11, so all these enemies are level 11. What happens is you'll have like, you know, from levels 10 to 20, you'll have, you know, a goblin type character. And then all of a sudden when you get to 21, it's now this giant ogre that does way more damage. So it's like there's these huge spikes in difficulty unless you perfectly, you know, optimize your min-max your character, you're going to have a really, really hard time even getting past anything. So,
yeah, I think I almost want to say that's getting to the right track. Instead of the art focus, they focus too much on your game character, right? Instead of the player. The ideal would be if the game is adjusting its difficulty, its level of challenge, based on your skill level. And that, if you think about it, it obviously sounds significantly easier than it actually would be to actually program this in, because it requires some pretty hefty AI. But if you could balance the challenge based on the player's skill, as opposed to just, because right now difficulty levels, we're just picking. We just go, oh, I think I'm good enough to play medium. I think I'm good enough to play hard. You know, we don't know. What does that even mean? These are labels that are different for every game.
You can only know that after you've beaten the game on one difficulty.
Exactly. You don't really know. I mean, you really can't tell. So, and the game is just kind of guessing too. Oh, this will probably challenge people that are this level, this sort of player.
This is recommended for people who have played FPSs before.
Yeah, they always say things like that.
Yeah.
Because they're trying to get you in that state. But if instead the game's enemies or the game's challenges could ramp up or down based on your play style to keep you in that flow state, I mean, maybe that would create maximum enjoyment. Or maybe not. I mean, maybe there are gamers that would prefer to, because part of what this kind of goes against as well is the failure state. And that's something that we haven't really talked about here when it gets into challenges. This is sort of assuming that your challenge, because when you're in flow, you're in the zone,
right?
You're in flow, the flow state, your skill and your, it sort of perfectly matches with the challenge that you have.
Right.
So you're able to overcome that challenge. It's just barely, but you're able to do it.
Right.
Whereas we're not thinking about the concept of failure.
Yeah, and which is a great way to learn in a game.
Exactly. So that's part of it, too. So, I mean, I certainly wouldn't want to take away failure. What do you think about that?
Well, the classic example is Dark Souls, or at least the example that gets brought up a lot of the time is...
You mean the prequel to Cuphead?
Yes.
Okay, good.
Where, basically, whenever you fail, it's your own fault. It's not the game's fault. And then you have to learn and adapt to whatever enemy you're fighting. Now, what they do in Dark Souls is that they actually make it way harder every time you fail, or that's how it was in Demon Souls anyway. I haven't played Dark Souls. But it would basically make the game significantly harder every time you fail so that you're really forced to learn and adapt. And other games like do that too, like Breath of the Wild. You learn how to do the combat by just doing it and then failing at it and then coming up with a new strategy.
Right.
And that's a good way to gate off exploration.
Big time. Yeah. Like the Lynels early on.
Right.
You learn to avoid those pretty quickly.
Yeah. And that's how the original Zelda did it. Like if they didn't want you getting into, you know, dungeon 8 right off the bat, they just put a few Lynels in the overworld and you would not be able to get past.
Exactly. You walk in and you see, okay, maybe there's one orange one. Maybe I can do this. And you start seeing the blues and you just run away.
Yeah. Speaking of Elder Scrolls, that's what Morrowind did too. And I think to a really good effect. It was all just a matter of how good your character was and whether or not they could beat the level, those enemies. Mm. So.
Yeah, I think that there has to be probably some sort of a balance there when we're talking about challenge, because I do think it can be fun to fail. I mean, I don't want to make it seem like you can only be within that flow state where you're just barely succeeding. So you're having that great sense of accomplishment. That's going to be so much more enhanced if you failed before and you have to earn that state. You have to earn getting to that point. Mm-hmm. And you really can't get to that point because we keep talking about skill. This is not there is such a thing as general skill at games, mm-hmm. but each game has its own skill too. You have to be good. Just because someone is like a master at fighting games because they played a lot of Street Fighter 2 doesn't mean they can pick up Super Smash Bros. And just dominate. Right. They're going to have it at somewhat of an advantage because they understand a lot of the intricacies of fighting games. But
well, also just
they
like,
have to learn that game. Like, what are
you
the
have to learn those characters. You have to learn the button combos and that mm-hmm. sort of thing. It's even harder.
You have to learn you have to learn priorities. You have to learn, hitboxes and all these little things that they might know, just so intimately with Street Fighter 2, but they may not know with Super Smash Bros. And vice versa, to use just a couple game examples. And obviously, I mean the superior Super Smash Bros. Experience, Nintendo 64 Super Smash Bros., the best one, bar none.
Melees.
Send your hate mail to Jim Bag.
Hashtag woke Jim.
I do think that there is something to be said about failure in games too, mm-hmm. That can help you get to this state so that you can gain the skill to eventually be in flow state. It's kind of like how do you earn that skill? And you want to feel like you've earned it by not just overcoming challenges, but failing at challenges, going, oh, whoa, what I just did there, that was dumb. I shouldn't do that anymore.
Yeah. And failing at challenges doesn't necessarily have to mean a character death either or a player
No, it
death.
Doesn't. That's a good
it
point.
It could be, as in the example of the Cuphead demo, failing to jump over that platform or jump over the first jump mm-hmm. in the tutorial.
Jumping's hard. I mean, jumping's difficult. It's hard.
Yeah, I mean.
Yeah. Dash and jump at the same time? Are you crazy?
Right, but I mean, in all seriousness, though, there's platforming
mechanics.
Two buttons
at the same time.
That you have to learn with any platformer, and if you can't get past one part of the stage, and you're just going to keep failing it, but then you're going to get good at doing that sort of jump, and then when you encounter it later on in the stage or in another stage, it's super easy for you.
Yeah, so we've talked a lot about challenge and skill level when it comes to. Mostly combat or platforming type challenges, mm-hmm. I've noticed. We've really been focusing on that. But there's other gameplay elements as well for games, like dialogue options for like dialogue choices or storytelling type mechanics in games where sometimes it's not just the game telling you what the story is, but you have a hand in crafting that story, and that might actually be a part of the gameplay.
Right.
Right. So is there something there? What do you think about that?
Yeah, well, I mean, speaking of dialogue options, it used to be in a lot of old computer RPGs like Baldur's Gate and stuff like that. Mm-hmm.
Planescape Torment, another good one.
Planescape Torment, yeah.
Big fan of that.
Fallout,
first few Fallouts.
Yeah, for sure. It used to be that a lot of dialogue options would actually, if you're not careful with what you're doing in dialogue, you could get yourself killed or at least get into a big fight that you didn't necessarily want. Mm-hmm. Or just have some sort of consequences.
That is so true.
You're doing.
Yeah. If you say, I know all the time in Baldur's Gate, sometimes you would be challenged by some really difficult enemies. And if you just go, I'm just going to be a jerk to this guy. He might try to kill you.
Yeah.
And he might be a really high level character.
Mm-hmm. And it might also depend on your persuasion skill to get him to stop fighting. But part of it's also just you need to have common sense when reading the dialogue and say, hey, if I don't want to die, maybe I shouldn't antagonize this mm-hmm. guy. It provides for actual realistic role playing, mm-hmm. Where you have a sense of self-preservation.
And for that, I do definitely think that factors into the fun factor. There is a challenge there, but it's a different sort of challenge. Mm-hmm. It's more of a, are you connecting with your character? Do you have a comprehension of what your character can do and how they might react in this situation? Right. And are you engaged in the game world enough to know that you shouldn't be openly challenging anyone that you meet, because anyone that you meet could be super high level, badass.
Well, it's also, the way you set up your stats from the beginning that kind of determines how you have to roleplay from then on out. Like if you specifically give yourself a bad speech skill or persuasion skill, I forget what it was called in Baldur's Gate. And if you deliberately give yourself that bad skill, then you're making the game a lot more challenging for yourself later on, where if you get in a situation where you need to be able to get out of a fight, you might not be able to. And that's a challenge because then you have to be prepared for combat in that situation.
Right. Well, I mean, with Planescape Torment, you could do, I'm sorry, not Planescape Torment, with Fallout, you could do the stupid character where you give yourself like really, really low intelligence. And now when you try to get into conversation with people, your dialogue options are just brutish. I think it's actually specifically Fallout 2, if I recall. Okay. But you would have all of these brutish responses. You wouldn't actually be able to communicate on the level of other characters. And it made it for a very fun and interesting experience, but a different kind of experience. And you're right, that did up the challenge. So there's definitely something there. I think that when it comes to something like that, I don't think that flow theory would necessarily apply because there is not that active... It's not as engaging, I guess you could say, as it's engaging in a different way. It's more of an intellectual challenge than it is a, I don't even know. It's not really a puzzle. Yeah, it's not, but you can get in flow state with a puzzle too, as part of it too. So it's not, but it's not even really a puzzle. It's more of a, an intellectual understanding. It's more like being careful.
It's role playing.
Yeah. It's role playing.
Yeah.
But I do think that there is challenge there and there's something to be said about that level, which we don't see that nowadays. We see, Mass Effect, where they go, you're basically saying the same thing. Do I want to accept this quest? Well, I'm going to be snarky.
Right.
Or I'm going to be serious. Or I'm going to be, you know, compassionate. I mean, it's, but you're saying the same thing. You're not really giving them a choice. It's you're just flavoring your speech.
I feel like I haven't played Mass Effect in a while, but I can't remember any meaningful choices that I made in that game except for like the last couple of, you know, do you want this ending or this ending?
I remember I made a very meaningful choice in Mass Effect 3 to turn it off.
That's a pretty good choice.
Okay, well, this has been episode 112 of the Backward-Compatible.com podcast. Wait, what?
You're right, you got that.
I got it right. Perfect, I did it.
You said 112, right?
I did, okay. I did. Chris, eat your heart out. I'm Jim.
I'm Nick.
And we'll see you next time.
We want you to write into the show because dialogue makes everyone better. If you want to comment on this episode, ask a question, share some info, voice an opinion, or request a topic, send an email to inbox@backward-compatible.com, and we may feature you on a future episode of the podcast. Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible. Backward Compatible.